The Biden administration would like to tout its economic accomplishments and what they have dubbed Bidenomics. However, Americans do not feel warm and fuzzy when they think about the state of the economy. So what exactly explains this disconnect? Now, the fact of the matter is there are some measures of the economy, there are some numbers you can look at that certainly look good for the Biden administration. They certainly can go out there and tout it, but it's actually frustrating a lot of American voters who feel that they're not reaping the benefits of what the Biden administration is touting. So for instance, the November unemployment rate of 3.7% is just 0.2 percentage points above its pre-pandemic level, which marked a five-decade low in joblessness. The annual inflation rate also plunged last month to 3.1% from a high of 9.1% in June of 2022, according to the Labor Department's Consumer Price Index. I just want to quickly interject here and say, okay, but the baseline went up, right? The inflation, like inflation means that the price of everything, the baseline prices of products that we need, essential goods that we need to buy, that went up. And then it continued to go up another 3%. So like, oh, inflation's slowing down. Yeah, but the price of everything is still super expensive. So it's like, are we just gonna pretend like that's not the truth? That's not the reality? Okay, I'm getting ahead of myself. Here are some more positive economic factors. US gross domestic product, GDP, is on track to rise at nearly pre-pandemic levels, far faster than the minimal or even negative growth projected by scores of economists. And the economy posted these strong top line numbers in the face of rapid Federal Reserve rate hikes, which bank officials admitted could tank the economy into a recession. Now they're arguing, no, it turns out no recession, even with the high interest rates. We had a soft landing, if you will. And so while the Biden administration wants to brag about this stuff and make it part of Biden's reelection campaign, fact of the matter is the American people aren't buying it. Biden's approval rating has fallen to a record low of 34%, according to a Monmouth University poll released last week, with nearly 70% of respondents disapproving of his handling of inflation. More than half of respondents disapproved of Biden's record on jobs, even as he presides over a historically strong labor market. Now, it is true that the unemployment rate is incredibly low, and that is something to celebrate. But as I said, when Trump was in office and the same thing was touted by the Trump administration, the quality of those jobs really does matter. If people are employed, that's great, but are they gainfully employed? Meaning, are they able to afford the goods and services they need? Are they able to afford housing? And a lot of Americans are like, no, we are not happy with our wages. We're not happy with inflation, even if it is slowing down. I'll give you more statements from people who are not so happy about the economy in just a moment. But Cenk, what are your thoughts so far? What do you think explains the disconnect?
So first of all, the numbers are good. Is it real? Yeah, it's real. So the inflation has come down. There's no question about it, but it still exists, to Anna's point. And so when you say, hey, inflation is not as bad as it used to be, it's damning with faint praise for a lot of voters, even though it's totally true, right? Unemployment is at a near record low, and Biden has created a ton of jobs. And by the way, this is what we've said now over many Republican and Democratic administrations. The head of the Fed deserves more credit and blame than any president does for these type of things. And I think the Federal Reserve shockingly has handled the inflation pretty well. They did bring it down fairly quickly. Wages have gone up a little bit, et cetera. So now that's the good news. But, and there's a big but coming here. So, and I'll give one more caveat to the Biden team, which is that media does matter. Like, and right-wing media has been saying it's awful, it's terrible, and it burrows into people's heads. Trump said 1,000 times how great he was at jobs, even though he created half of the jobs that Biden did. He scores 19 points higher than Biden does on jobs because he's good at marketing. So that also matters. But I think the real explanation here is in the roller coaster. So what happened was we get hit by COVID and a lot of people lose their jobs. We're in a really bad situation. And then we did something really good. It started in the Trump administration, and then Biden's first bill, the COVID relief plan, was really positive. And that's when everybody was high on Biden, right? And they were talking about him being FDR 2.0 and all these things. At that point, people got a big influx of government cash. And then all of a sudden, they were feeling pretty good, surprisingly, in those years. Then what happened? All of it sunset. And so Joe Manchin and Joe Biden let him do it, pulled the rug out. So the child tax credit was gone. So many things that helped the average American at that time were gone. And then they got hit with inflation. So now all of a sudden, the money that they got used to for a second, they felt like was taken away from them by Joe Biden. Fairly or unfairly.
The savings that they were able to accumulate as a result of the economic stimulus provided during coronavirus, the pandemic, that was all depleted as a result of inflation, right? So you're right about the roller coaster effect, but there are other factors that I think we should get into as well.
Continue. Yeah, just to finish that thought.
Yeah.
So when you had the child tax credit, et cetera, taken away from you, Ari Riebenhaft wrote a really good piece about this in The Intercept, former top campaign official for Bernie Sanders. All of a sudden, people, and when you have something taken away from you, it feels, it's a psychological phenomenon where it feels much worse than if you never got it in the first place. Okay? So then they feel like, oh no, that got taken away. And then inflation hits. And remember, about 40% of the country can't survive a $400 hit. When you add up the what all the prices that went up, it's about, you know, I haven't done the math on it and I haven't seen an economist on it, but could that total $400 for an average person, for eggs, gasoline, all the things that went up, let alone if you had to buy a car, let alone rent,
yeah,
right? It's gonna be way more than $400. So all of a sudden they get hit with a double whammy, and they don't think, hey, Biden passed the bill in the first place. They think, and they don't think supply chain issues, and Biden never talks about it. He never makes his own case. So they think, well, under Biden, over the last 2 years, my life got worse. And that is also true.
Okay, so I have a few things to say. Number one, let's dispel the notion that the Biden administration had anything to do at all with wages going up. The Biden administration did zero in regard to wages, zero. Didn't fight for a minimum wage increase. The reason, why did wages go up, Cenk? Do you know?
Yeah, well, obviously what happened was because of the supply chain and inflation and the lack of, and the fact that the, one way you can give them credit though is low unemployment, because that was supply and demand issue that led to people having to raise wages to be able to hire people because of that. So, but overall, you're absolutely right. The federal minimum wage was not increased.
No, no.
Biden took no action. It was market forces that forced some of those companies
to
raise
wages. There was a tight labor market,
okay?
A tight labor market, which for the first time in a very long time brought corporations to their knees and had no choice but to raise wages in order to attract labor, in order to operate and function properly. That's why. The other reason why, let's not forget, is that workers who were lucky enough to already be organized and unionized decided, you know what, we're gonna practice our labor rights and we're gonna strike. And that includes workers at John Deere, that includes workers, you know, the rail workers, as we all know, the UAW workers. Wages didn't increase because the federal government, under the leadership of Joe Biden, did the right thing. In fact, I would venture to say that Joe Biden abandoned American workers in regard to wages specifically. Now, at the same time, one other thing I'll say, he does deserve credit though in regard to the individuals he appointed for the National Labor Relations Board, which provided far more protection for organizing workers than the prior administration under Donald Trump. So he deserves credit on that. But I don't want anyone to take credit away from the workers themselves, who in many cases put a lot on the line and really nearly sacrificed their own livelihoods and their own jobs in order to demand better pay, better benefits, and better working conditions from their bosses.
Yeah, I'm just gonna agree with you on two things. The tight labor market is the easiest way to describe what I was trying to describe. There's no question, and you saw it at McDonald's, et cetera, putting up signs of $18 an hour, $17 an hour. I saw it in the middle of the country too. So, and they're not doing that for their health. They're doing that because they need the workers. They didn't have a choice. And unions did a fantastic job over the last couple of years in increasing wages for folks. But to main point that Anna is making about the Biden administration, if you remember, there was a time when wages started to go up significantly because of that tight labor market. And then all of a sudden, Fox News, MSNBC, CNBC, CNN, all of them were like, no, this is a real big problem. It's gonna lead to bigger inflation. We can't have the workers making more money, no way. And the Biden administration, instead of fighting back against that, seemed to aid and abet it with administration officials saying that they're concerned about rising wages. When in reality, what Biden could have done, let's be constructive about it. He could have gone up there and said, look, your prices are already going up. Your wages have to go up to match it. Mm-hmm. So I'm gonna fight harder for your wages to go up. Mm-hmm. I'm gonna push for the federal $15 minimum wage so that everybody could get the bare minimum. I'm gonna do all these things to fight for you guys. Even if you don't think that that's great policy, first of all, you're wrong. But even if you think it's not, as a matter of politics, if you just sit there and you don't address the inflation, and you don't go out there and go, I'm gonna get you higher wages. I'm gonna fight for you so you can fight back against inflation. Well, of course they're not gonna give you credit for it. And behind the scenes, you killed the $15 minimum wage, and we all know that, right? So you were counterproductive.
The other thing I wanna just note is a different factor or measure that the Biden administration likes to point to, and supporters of the Biden administration like to point to, is how consumer spending is strong, it's up. Consumers are shelling out the big bucks, right? And I'm curious how they do their analysis, because if inflation, I mean, look, inflation has slowed down, but if inflation led to higher prices for essential items that Americans need, they literally have no choice but to pay more for the essential items that they need. Is that factored into their analysis, or are they just saying like Americans are spending more money, consumer confidence is high? I'm curious about that.
Yeah, and so as people are spending more, partly because they have to, it's not a great thing to brag about. I agree with Anna. Yes, I'm sure that they're doing more shopping too. Look, the economy's rebounding, so that's why I keep telling you this is a mixed issue, right? Mm-hmm. And going into 2024, it looks pretty good to the point where it gives me a little bit of hope. But you need the leader to go out there and address people's concerns.
Like housing.
And what did Biden do to address the concerns about housing, about inflation, about wages? And the reality is, in a best case scenario, even his defenders would have to say, he didn't do anything. And they all say like, well, I mean, he's really good on the substance, but he's not a good communicator. Well, sorry, but if you're gonna run for president, you really need to be a good communicator. And so you can't do a terrible job of communicating your message and then complain that people didn't get the message.
Hey, thanks for watching that video. We really appreciate it, guys. And we appreciate it if you become members, because that allows us to be independent, honest, progressive, all the things that you don't get from corporate media. And all of that is because of you guys. Hit the join button below and become one of us, become a Young Turk.